Simon & Schuster Australia presents The Diggers of Colditz, the classic Australian POW story about escape from the inescapable. Written by Jack Champ and Colin Burgess. Narrated by Stephen Shanahan. This book is dedicated to two Pats, Pat Champ and Pat Burgess. It is also dedicated to the indomitable spirit of mankind under adversity. Foreword to the 1997 edition by P.R. Reed. I was delighted when Lieutenant Commander Mike Moran, duty stooge of the Colditz Association, told me that Jack Champ and Colin Burgess were planning to write a book about the diggers in Colditz. Since then, Colin Burgess and I have met on several occasions, and any doubts I may have had before getting to know him were very soon dispelled. To him, this book was clearly a labour of love. There were about 20 Australians in Colditz Castle, and without exception, their personalities were intriguing. Sometimes larger than life, generally very individualistic, never dull. They were a group of bold and resourceful men. Their presence testified to the global nature of the conflict of the Second World War, as also to the intrinsic nobility and selfless courage of their participation in it. Their story is long overdue. Almost a year before Jack Champ arrived in Colditz, I went AWOL. I met him for the first time at our 1980 reunion at the Imperial War Museum. I am, of course, well informed about the escaping feats of the diggers who landed up in Offlag 4C and their part in the life of that camp. It is nowadays a recognised honour to have been in Colditz. It says something for the resilient spirit of man that those Allied prisoners, the inveterate escapers who were sent to Colditz, mostly survived the ordeal. For such men, much more than for others, the hours were days and the weeks were years. They were men of action by nature, and they lived a long time the torture of forced inactivity. They were prisoners expiating no other crime than the unselfish service of their country. The desire to escape was paramount among the men of Colditz. They were of all nationalities fighting on the Allied side, Englishmen, Scotsmen and Irishmen from Britain and every corner of the Commonwealth, Canada, Australia, New Zealand and Africa. This book tells the story of the Colditz Australians. Eminently readable, it will, I am sure, earn a distinctive place in Colditz literature, which now includes some 70 books written in at least 5 languages. P.R. Reed, MBE, MC, author of The Colditz Story. Introduction by Colin Burgess. To Jack Champ and the men of Colditz, I was a comparative youngster when this book was first conceived. I had not even been born at the time of their liberation and returned to their homes and loved ones. For most of them, the transition from the deprivation, loneliness, and degradation of the prison camps to the security, warmth, and freedom of their own home environment caused many varying and profound emotions. The majority wanted to forget those lost years, to re-establish civilized human contact and move freely again in a life without guards, locked doors, barred windows and barbed wire. Let Colditz become a memory. And thus it was until Major Pat Reed, who had successfully escaped from the ancient castle, wrote his deservedly classic book, The Colditz Story. In the ensuing years, the many stories about Colditz were perpetuated through his second brilliant book, The Latter Days. The excellent black and white film based on his books and the rather ostentatious but highly successful television series. In a lesser propagation of the legend as it has now become, there have been books written by former British, Dutch, French, American and Polish POWs from the infamous castle. There is even a Colditz board game. It was Pat Reed who first inspired me to tackle this book when he told me that the story of the Australians he had known in Colditz was one of the great untold tales of the war. J. Jack Champ and I first met in late 1981, after I had contacted the surviving Australians to ascertain their interest in a book on their exploits. Jack told me that he had quite a lot of information in the form of an unpublished manuscript to which he would happily give me access. Having read the manuscript, I put it to him that we co-author a fresh book, this time incorporating the stories I would obtain from the rest of the Aussies. We shook hands on this agreement, and subsequently became not only complimentary writers, but lifelong friends. I feel I must emphasise that in the German POW camps described throughout the book, and in particular Colditz Castle, the Australians were a minority contingent. Although the reader may gain the impression that they were all to the fore in the escaping game, they had their counterparts, obviously stronger numerically, in other nationalities. To attempt to tell the stories of these fine men is to travel over ground already well covered in previous books. Their omission is regretted, but the admiration for their deeds is undiminished. There are several to whom Jack and I owed and owe our sincere thanks for their kind assistance. The mere listing of names can in no way suggest our tremendous feelings of gratitude towards these individuals. We are greatly indebted to all of them. Without their interest and cooperation, it would have been literally impossible to collect, transcribe, organise, or publish the information and stories contained in this book. First, and indeed foremost, to Mike Muggsy Moran. As principal motivator of the Colditz Association, he tirelessly assisted when information or verification was needed, and his gracious support lent much of the soul to this book. Mike and his wife, Rena, remained very dear friends until they passed away within months of each other in 1993. Likewise, Pat Reed gave unflinching help despite being embroiled in writing his final work, Colditz, The Full Story. This intrepid escaper, a man I am proud to have called a friend over the latter years of his life, died on the 22nd of May 1990, aged 79. We enjoyed the wonderful support given us by other Colditz veterans, such as David Walker, a courageous leader and author of such literary masterpieces as Geordie, Harry Black and the Tiger, and Lean, Wind, Lean. When he knew our book was underway, he wrote the following tribute to the Australians he had known during the war. Without exception, the Australians were tough, and some, not all, were rough too. Not always the most appealing of people to us hidebound pommies when things were easy. But when bread was to be measured and treasured by the millimetre, it was quite another matter. They were champions in adversity. The best men in prison, as I wrote later in a novel called The Pillar. In 1965, I went to Australia to see my old cobbers again and to make new friends. Since then, I've been back twice, to be treated with kindness all along the way. A good hard breed from a good hard land about sums it up for me. So many other former Colditz POWs assisted us throughout the research and writing of this book, and their help, either requested or spontaneous, is gratefully acknowledged. They were Jock Hamilton Bailey, Don Donaldson, Hugh Bruce, Dominic Bruce, Ken Lockwood, and Mike Whittett. Family members and friends who supplied information and photographs were Peter Champ, Phyllis Holroyd, Nell McComb, Malcolm McComb Jr., Bonnie Balding, Kit Rawson, Harley Baxter, Mona Whaley, and George and Mary Watson. Post-war members of the Colditz Society also demonstrated their willingness to help. Michael Booker, David Ray, Mario Bosch and Dave Windle in England, and Jonathan Vance in Canada. In pre-personal computer days, Val Mills volunteered to type out our original manuscript and did so superbly and expeditiously. In copying and reproducing many irreplaceable photographs from the war years, my ongoing thanks goes to a great mate, Rob Croft. Last, but certainly not least, to the men known as the Diggers of Colditz, who gave freely of their time and memories. Scattered throughout Australia, they and their families made this book a lot easier to put together through their enthusiasm and support. Sadly, since this book was first published back in 1985, all of the Colditz luminaries named within its pages, including Jack Champ, have passed away. It was nevertheless a pleasure and a privilege to have shared many memorable days with these remarkable men, and I know they all took great, if somewhat modest, pride in the fact that their stories had finally been told. In March 1996, my wife Pat and I enjoyed making a trip to Colditz Castle, and it was truly the experience of a lifetime. We were cordially greeted by the curator of the Colditz Museum, Jens Malmen, and he took us on a personal tour of the museum and the ancient Schloss. As I stood in the small cobbled courtyard I had first read about as a youngster, those adventurous tales of the Colditz POWs came back to me, and I could feel all around me the spirit that was off lag for sea. Nowadays the castle is floodlit by night, just as it was during the war years, and is a truly dramatic and even spectral sight. As Jack Champ once reminded me, we probably saw more of the exterior of the castle in 2 days than he did during his 2 years as a prisoner at Colditz. A visit to Colditz is a relatively easy accomplishment these days, and I urge anyone who has ever thrilled to the Colditz stories to pay the picturesque town and old Schloss a visit. There is no disappointment in store, except that the town's brewery has recently closed down, and a tall glass of Colditz beer is no longer available. Bad news for any Australian. The chance to revise and enlarge this book some 35 years after it was first published came as a very welcome surprise. I am therefore grateful to publisher Brandon Van Over and editor Shannon Kelly from Simon & Schuster Australia for recognising the potential in releasing an updated version of what, over the decades, has become a classic tale in Australian military history and of heroic circumstances under adversity. Following the release of the original edition of this book, many reviewers took the opportunity to point out the difference between life as a prisoner of the Germans and those in Japanese hands. It is recognised that the Germans, to varying degrees, obeyed the strictures of the Geneva Convention, while the Japanese viciously applied their own code of Bushido, which entailed the most monstrous activities ever perpetrated on members of the human race. While some readers may find it curious to read, for instance, about an Anzac Day feast in the heart of Germany, while such horrors as the Sandokan Death March and the attempted annihilation of Gull Force on Ambon were being carried out elsewhere.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.